Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another Views on Africa. This morning we'll be talking about Guinea-Bissau, a very interesting country in West Africa. We'll be looking at the political crisis and see how the country one more time can avoid relapsing into another deadly political conflict. Guinea-Bissau obtained its independence in 1975, but since then the country has not been able to really put in place strategies and mechanisms to transform the small, tiny, and impoverished West African state into a viable and economically prosperous entity. In fact, the country has been embroiled into a political conflict since then, experiencing numerous coups emanating from the state's fragility. Recently, in August, on the 13th of August, the newly elected president, Jose Mariova, dismissed his prime minister and shut down the government, plunging one more time Guinea-Bissau into yet another political crisis. But what many see as a feud between the two personalities, that is the president and the prime minister, goes beyond the clash of personality. I think it needs to be located into structural as well as speculative factors that continue to undermine the peace and stability in Guinea-Bissau. And that's what we're going to try to explore this morning. What are those issues that continue to stand as impediment to political stability in Guinea-Bissau? And then trying to look at possible scenarios as the crisis unfolds. To understand crisis, we are going to look at a number of issues. First of all, we are going to explore some of the contentious issues that the president raised and see how much they weigh in to what is happening, and try to go a little bit beyond that. Two, we're going to look at the mediation effort that has been put in place so far to help Guinea-Bissau authorities to navigate through this situation. Three, what impact has the current crisis has on the country effort in terms of our peace building process? Four, what next? What do we expect? What are the possible scenario, the likely scenario that we can witness in Guinea-Bissau? And finally, what is the way forward for the country? In terms of understanding the current situations, we would like to remind that Guinea-Bissau really emerged from a very difficult electoral process in 2004, and that saw the elections of Jose Mario Vaz Eka Jomap, to cut it short, elected as a president, and Domingo Simos Pereira, DSP, as a prime minister, and also to me, a leader for the African Party of Independence for Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde, PIGC. Those developments were seen as a positive happening for Guinea-Bissau, as both leaders came from the same party, probably will serve as element of political stability and cohesion to steer the action of government that will help Guinea-Bissau to overcome the security and socio-economic challenges that the country is facing. In fact, this could help in addressing the deficit of governance. But indeed, when we have this crisis, it brings to the fore that fundamental transformation of institutional setting in Guinea-Bissau still needs some efforts, seriously. To justify the dismissal of the prime minister as well as the whole government, the president mentioned corruption cases involving some members of the government, probably close to the prime minister, on which he failed to act. Specifically, allegations on illegal exploitation of country's minerals, particularly timber, appear to play a central role in this new development. According to the UK advocacy group Global Timber, the timber export in Guinea-Bissau has grown exponentially, as well as the license attributed to those exploiting and the timber in Guinea-Bissau. For example, I think the exploitation, the export, jumped from 80 cubic meters in 2008 to 15,000 cubic meters in 2013. Particularly, most of it took place within the transition period, where some of the licenses have been attributed allegedly illegally to people who were not allowed to exploit this material. Some argue that the overflow and the big interest that we are witnessing in the timber industry emanated from the successful action taken in Guinea-Bissau to crack down the narco traffic, which really prevents the country or some key element within the military and political arena from exploiting drug trafficking as a source of income in Guinea-Bissau. That needs to be seriously investigated, though. This decision to cap the illegal exploitation of timber has forced the president to impose a 5-year ban on the exploitation of particularly unprocessed timber from Guinea-Bissau. That could also be another element of contention between the leaders of the country. But to go beyond those elements, I think serious observation of Guinea-Bissau revealed that the current crisis could be attributed to the early achievement of a Prime Minister Domingos Simões Pereira government. He is credited with effort to restore good governance, improve country's revenues, rule of law, and prevent a backlash from the former military rulers linked to drug smuggling. Under his leadership also, it's argued that most international aid has resumed. Yet, in his action or through his action, he is seen as consolidating his own power, purging politicians and officials that are seen as connected to old political or to old regime. Within the PIGC itself, DSP, as the president, as the party chairman, as the prime minister, enjoys an overwhelming support, both within the party and also at the National Assembly. And that really puts him at the loggerheads with the president. And many believe that the president's reaction came as a deterrent to the threat posed by the rising prime minister, who is seen as a potential rival in the years to come for his own political survival. Let us say that Guinea-Bissau emerged in 2014 from a difficult electoral process to put the country back to political normalcy. But in that electoral process, if that electoral process has restored the democratization process and revived the hope for reforms, old deep-seated antagonism remain very sharp between reformists and defenders of the status quo, not only within the PIGC, but also in the entire country. We have seen previous episodes opposing, for example, the former Prime Minister Carlos Gomez Jr. and the late Bernardo Lino Vieira, continuing into the also late President Malam Bakaisana, which really brings the questions, the opposition to some deep reform that the country needed to need to move forward. In fact, some of those reforms are seen as threatening the drug lords who have strong grip on the country's political organ. Another element that we think is very important to share is that the political institutional arrangement in Guinea-Bissau remain the key factor of crisis, an element of instability. Because since the return of PIGC to power in 2004, because you remember that in 2000 the PIGC has lost power to the philosopher Kumba Yala, who also mismanaged and was removed from power, prompting to another election in 2004. That saw the PIGC coming back, but since then has remained a very strong political force in Guinea-Bissau. But one thing that appeared clear, and the thing that we can see since then, is that the relationship between the president, the prime minister, and the army have been extremely complex, resulting in a cyclical crisis in which the army remains the main game changer. And in 2009, Guinea-Bissau experienced one of the most dramatic episodes in the conflictual, in that conflictual relationship, when President Viera was killed 1 hour after his army chief of staff, Tagme Nawai, was assassinated. In 2011, the country experienced the same crisis as a result of the conflict between the prime minister and the presidency. Indeed, the army may not want to seize and control power in Guinea-Bissau, but to remain a very important pole of influence in the country. Let's just say that since 1975, no president in Guinea-Bissau has served a full 5-year term, which raised very serious questions about sustainability of political transition in Guinea-Bissau. The country can be extremely successful in holding post-crisis elections, but in terms of managing, it's become extremely difficult. Let us now turn to a mediation effort so far and see the number of actors involved. We have realized that the early attempt to resolve the crisis were initiated by President Macky Sall of Senegal, acting as the chairman of the Economic Community of West African States, together with his counterpart from Guinea, Alpha Condé. The efforts were to try and invite the key protagonists of the crisis to dialogue, to give a chance to the semblance of normalcy that Guinea-Bissau has recently recovered. We have also seen that Nigerian President Muhammadu Buhari has also taken given attention to the crisis by appointing former President Olusegun Obasanjo as a mediator to accompany the dialogue in Guinea-Bissau. At the institutional level, the African Union Peace and Security Council also was involved, reminding the key actors about their commitment to help Guinea-Bissau in a new dispensation, in actually implementing the new dispensation that came after the 2014 elections, and called for political dialogue to preserve the fragile gains that the country has achieved so far. The UN Security Council reminded the actors also of the possibility of their responsibility to make sure that the peace building process remain on track. Now, individual countries such as Portugal also played a very important role. Let us remember that Portugal is a member of the community of Portuguese-speaking countries, while Angola, though absent so far, but remain very attentive, following carefully what's happening in Guinea-Bissau. Angola's role in Guinea-Bissau has been controversial, forcing the authorities to request the exit of Angola from the region, but it does not mean that Angola is not following what is happening. It depends on what side you are, on the side of the reformists or those who want to maintain a status quo. Angola still remains a very important partner in Guinea-Bissau by solidarity. A key concern here is that the president of Guinea-Bissau gave little attention to various calls from international partners to reconsider his decision and reappoint the prime minister. He proceeds and move ahead to appoint a controversial new prime minister, Bachirou Jar, and now is about to form a new government in a partnership with Party of Social Renovation, PRS, formerly led by Kumba Yala, just to help you remember what is PRS. against the will of his the support of his own party, the PIGC. Extraordinary move. The president might currently seem to find the solution to the problem, but this is not sustainable as the PIGC remain a powerful entity and has a majority in the National Assembly. What could be the potential impact of the crisis, Guinea-Bissau? I think this time around, we can say that the crisis has not generated into violence as we used to see in the country, previously seen in the country. The army has remained relatively neutral and calm. In fact, they have vowed that they are not going to be involved in the crisis so far. We have also observed few peaceful protests that took place to challenge the president's decision to remove his prime minister. Yet, there are concerns of fear of collapse of the transitions that might compromise the gains achieved under the new political dispensation so far. There are also concerns about the stagnation of the economic recovery, or maybe the revenues of the country. In fact, the International Monetary Fund has already issued a warning that the country is losing close to $10 million, much needed to respond to some of the social and socio-economic challenges of the country. There are also concerns about the sustainability of donors' commitment to accompany Guinea-Bissau on its path to peace, reconciliation and development. Because if the country persists, all the promises made at the Brussels conference in March might actually hang somewhere without a following up. Now, what are the possible scenario in terms of the development of this situation if a quick solution is not found? There are three possible elements that we can look at here. The first one is because of the antagonism between the prime minister and the president, probably the president has the power to dissolve the National Assembly and call for new legislative elections. But the key question here is, given all the troubles that Guinea-Bissau went through last year to hold both the presidential legislative elections, will the country be able to do that? It looks unlikely to me, both from technical, financial, logistical point of view, but also from the position of international community and members who are not prepared to get into another political venture that might simply compromise the effort made so far. Besides, it is not even sure that if a new legislative election is held, that will change the political configuration of the National Assembly so far, because the PIGC will still remain the powerful political party and is likely to win the majority of the assembly and will propose a prime minister who will remain the same person. So it's not really going to change anything in Guinea-Bissau. Will we see a military coup in Guinea-Bissau? Ordinarily, yes. In a situation like that, when a compromise cannot be found between the president and the prime minister, a coup is very quick to come. But in the current context, I think the third center of power is being watched closely by all the key actors of the international community. And this brings us to just highlight a number of mitigating factors. One of them is the dissuasive presence of ECOWAS Stabilization Force, ECOMIB, in the country that replaced the Angolan troops in Guinea-Bissau. I think that force is there to make sure that the army remains where it belongs. The second one is that the UN Security Council has imposed sanctions on the military junta, including the former army chief of staff Antonio Injai, very influential within the military as well. And thirdly, the international pressure on the army currently, calling the army not to move and not to do anything that would jeopardize the political transition, for me is a very, very positive element to mention. But we are in Guinea-Bissau, and those pressure might be a result, but the army is also as unpredictable as the political situation of Guinea-Bissau. So anything can happen. So if it is difficult today to see a military coup, it is not impossible for it to take place if the deadlock continues. In conclusion, the return of Guinea-Bissau to constitutional order following the sudden death of Malamba Kaisana and the 2014 turbulent electoral process offers a new window of opportunity to revive the reform agenda and complete successfully the transition to a more stable and economically prosperous nation. The current crisis in Guinea-Bissau stands as a reminder that serious reform needs to be completed, including the transformation of the political system that continues to remain the main source of political tension regardless of who comes to power. And while the SSR has been on the agenda for some time now, or for years now, it is necessary to increase the pressure and support to accelerate this process, because it's quite interesting that everything turns or revolves around the security sector reform, which is taking one step forward and two steps backwards in Guinea-Bissau. And that's only not regarding the army, but also other state institutions that need to be reinforced to help the state to project its power beyond the capital or city. The justice component appears even more necessary to be able to investigate alleged cases of corruption involving government officials or military officials. And finally, peace consolidations in Guinea-Bissau depends largely on the reinforcement of institutional capacity of the state organs to resolve crises without resorting to violence. So I think these are some of the elements that I would like to share with you this morning. And we'd like to take your questions and comments and provide further details on any issue that you might want to raise. Thank you for your attention.